Please welcome Ricky.
To be here at TEDx in Schenectady, to be able to share my ideas and my views and my thoughts in such an amazing forum is one of the most important things for me. Because the stuff that she just described, the things that I do, the work that I do, is all for the purpose of what I consider to be the most significant point in my life, and that is to be a voice for the voiceless. And when I say the voiceless, I'm referring specifically to young people of color, poor people who are living in urban communities, who are dealing with many of the elements that we've identified throughout the talks today: environmental issues, equity issues, racial injustice, police brutality, substance abuse issues, mass incarceration, and the likes. And part of the reason why I decided to be, or actually I felt called to be, a voice for the voiceless is because I share a similar narrative to many of the young people that I work with. I understand what it is to struggle with poverty, to have to collect bottles in the morning just so you can get enough food, for enough money for lunch. I know what it's like to have a parent who struggles with substance abuse issues. I know what it's like to have a father who was killed after my father was actually killed a month before I was born. And so with that said, it's interesting because I always say that I was kind of born into trauma. I was born into abuse. And it just recently dawned on me the state that my mother must have been in to have her child's father shot and killed, to get the call to hear that her child's father had been murdered right before she was giving birth. And so, similar to the young people that I worked with, I also had some of the consequences. I experienced some of the consequences that the young people are dealing with. I was incarcerated at the age of 16. As a young man striving to identify myself, trying to figure out who I was in the midst of all of these negative stereotypes, all of these elements that were inflicting our community. And I chose the path that seemed the most prevalent within my community. I chose to follow the other young men who were on the corners, fatherless, searching for an identity. And essentially, we were like the blind leading the blind. And we all led ourselves in the same direction. And that direction for me, and that destination for me, was a space that I found my voice. And that was in a maximum security prison. I found my voice in a prison after I had realized that there was a reason for why I conducted myself the way that I did. The reason why I was so self-destructive and constantly putting myself in harm's way. And it wasn't until this one instance in which I was conducting a group with other men in prison, because at this point I realized that because my experiences weren't unique, the answer that I discovered through my experiences were answers that could help improve the lives of other people. And it was one evening I was conducting a group with about 41 other prisoners. And I always told guys that if you have an issue that you're dealing with, it takes precedent over any topic that we decided on. And this one particular night, this Latino gentleman raises his hand and he says, "Hey, I have something that I want to talk to you about." And I said, "You know, we're all family here, we're all we have. Of course, share it." And then he commenced to tell me a story and tell the group a story about how his daughter, who was 9 years old, was being molested. And that every time he called home, his child's mother would say that she didn't believe it, but yet and still his daughter would continuously cry. It even got to the point where the mother was actually blaming the daughter. And this was heart-wrenching. But what it did is it opened up a conversation among the group members. And it wasn't until this extremely large man who in the streets was named Truck, that was his street name. And he was a notorious stick-up kid in Boston. And he stood up and he said, "You know, I was a victim of sexual abuse." And then he started to talk about what that experience meant to him. And he said, "I've never shared that information with anyone." And then, don't you know, out of that group of 41 men, I posed the question, who else had been a victim of childhood sexual abuse? And everyone raised their hand with the exception of one, including myself. And that's part of what I want to talk to you about today, is male victims of childhood sexual abuse, as it relates to my first exposure to the oppression that drove my passion, or that drives my passion to be the voice for the voiceless young people that I work with. Because one of the things that we don't think about, and when we talk about childhood sexual abuse, is the experience of young men. We really have a lot of research that looks at the experience of young women. And it's understandable, right? Because we want to take care of our little girls. You know, it's actually to the point where our young boys, a mom would never, ever, ever leave her daughter alone with a man. I don't care how close that man is to the family. But that same mom, especially if she's a mother who is a single parent, may actually try to encourage a relationship with a man, with their daughter, with their son. She may actually try to get that young boy into a program that can provide mentorship that has other men. You know, we've seen that in the Sandusky case in Penn State, where this man was a professional, he was a coach who ran a mentorship program. Parents sent their children, specifically their boys, to this man. We've seen that with the Catholic Church scandal, sexual scandal. And so we know now that 1 in 6 young men are under the age of 18 have been victims of childhood sexual abuse. And I was one of them. But what I did derive from this experience was this passion. This passion to always speak truth to power, this passion to be the voice for the voiceless. And most importantly, to try to empower those people who were suffering. And it was therapeutic for me. It gave me enough energy to do things when I didn't want to do them, to go above and beyond, to reach out to young people, to go to their homes. And it was also driven by an anger. It was actually driven by an anger, a rage against injustice. It was driven by a rage against oppression. And this rage was enough, it was very sufficient in providing me with the energy that I needed to move forward. But one thing happened. I realized that the rage and the anger was not enough. I realized that all of this anger and this rage was enough to push me to do this work with the young people and their families that I was working with. But at the same time, it came at the expense of my own healing process. Carl Jung talks about this concept of the wounded healer. Those people who've been affected by the same issues of the population that they're working with, or the people that they're working with. Us being the most significant and the ones who are capable of engaging them and helping them and supporting them the most. But I argue that sometimes it comes at the expense of our own healing process. It comes at the expense of really getting so engaged in this process of helping others that we fail to realize that there's still some healing that needs to take place within us. And so I asked the question, who is going to heal the wounded healer? Because oftentimes, we get put out into the forefront because people understand our value, and we get used to the point where we neglect our own well-being. And then, what I started to notice among my peers, other people who are equally committed to this work, is that we started to display these behaviors that were indicative of that lack of healing. We would drink too much. Some of my friends who were like the most courageous, the most dedicated workers in the community would become over-sexualized, would be in abusive relationships where they would take out some of their frustrations on their partners. And that's what it caused me to look at myself and I said, wait a minute, what's happening with me? And then I realized that I was not exempt. When I started to reflect on myself outside of the work, I started to see that I exhibited the same self-destructive behavior pattern. Despite my title as a director, despite the work that I was doing in the community, despite all of the attention that I received for being someone who was committed to social justice, I also was engaging in self-sabotaging, self-destructive destructive behavior. Behavior that caused me to lose something that is the most dear to me. It caused me to lose, It caused me to lose my family. Because here I was, out here trying to change the world, trying to empower so many young people. And then I realized that I was taking out a lot of my rage and frustration on the home front. I was hurting the woman who loved me more than anything, who understood me with all of my flaws and my background and my history. And it wasn't like abusive physically, but it was through neglect. It was through a lot of this anger that was driving the same, that was driving my efforts in the community that were causing me to receive all these accolades. And I did not want to compromise it because that identity was established well before I became a father and well before I became a husband. And so, at the expense of my family, I committed myself, continued to commit myself to this work and lost something so dear to me. And it was at this point, last year, because this is very recent for me, that it caused me to look at the need for me to continue my healing process. And it caused me to recognize that no matter what I was doing out in the community, no matter what I was doing to help other people, if it came at the expense of my healing process, that eventually it would start to manifest itself in life, in my life, where it would be counterproductive. And so what I ask you all today is think about this healing process, because we know that many of the people who go into the field, the social service field, the health profession, are people who share a similar narrative to the population or the people that they're serving. And they thrive, and it's so therapeutic, and it's so beneficial to be able to use your story as a means to empower other people. But sometimes that empowerment of others comes from the depleted power, the power that's within, that has not been truly formed and shaped, the power that is a derivative of the healing process that we need to continuously engage ourselves in. So anyone who's in this audience, anyone who's listening, who's engaged in this work, and we know that we have wounded healers on our team and our agencies, I plead with you to keep them mindful of the need for them to heal themselves so they can develop the N-I-N-empowerment that they need through the process of healing to truly be the leaders who can empower others. Because the other thing that I realized is that anger and rage is not consistent with doing this work. Anger and frustration with oppression is not going to be the continuous driving force behind this work. I recently learned that Mother Teresa never involved herself in anything that was anti. It was always about pro. And to me, that speaks to another level of compassion. And for me, at this point in my life, that's what I'm hoping to inspire my work. Not a hatred for injustice, but a love for justice, right? Not a hatred for inequality, but a desire to see more equality in our country. And so I'm hoping that I can continuously be driven by compassion and love and a desire to care and help others, as opposed to the anger that drove me so intensely in the past, that I can be empowered within and then ultimately empower so many other people, in which that is, I believe, to be my calling. And so with that, I say thank you so much for this opportunity. Seasoned staff person who's here in the audience, and we provide academic and non-cognitive support to about 300 young people, 5th through 12th grade in the Albany City School District. Previously, I was actually the director of the Learning Partnerships Program here in Schenectady, where I had first-hand contact with those communities that you mentioned earlier, those communities that are intensely impoverished and have, you know, little access to the resources needed for them to have a quality lifestyle.
It's been my experience, both personally and in my work, that quite often that anger and rage has no name. It's not understood why it's there. And the person angry and raging is doing so for reasons that they don't quite understand until someone points out to them or digs deep and finds out why it's there. Do you in your work try to do that in the people, in the children, in the young adults that you see?
Absolutely. I think one of the things that is important, because anger can be useful initially, right? Because one of the things that a friend of mine said to me last night about childhood sexual abuse is that it robs you of your confidence before you even realize you have confidence. It steals your security. You know, it steals your safety. And so many of the young people that we work with are dealing with multiple forms of abuse and circumstances that have robbed them of their confidence, robbed them of their security. And so a big part of what we do is, for the purpose of empowering them, giving them back their voice, while simultaneously engaging them in that healing process. So it's not just this rage that's being misplaced, it's learning how to harness this energy, this anger, through utilizing your voice for the positive construction of the projects within your community, like we're doing in the summer. We're using youth-led participatory action research and hip-hop pedagogy to engage young people in local community organizing around issues that impact their community. But simultaneously, we're gearing up to make sure that we have clinical staff there to help them with that healing process.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Oh,
sorry.
It's a purely theoretical question. I'm curious to hear, you discovered at some point that you were self-destructive. And I'm wondering, someone came up to you maybe a year before that or 2 years before that and pointed it out, would you be able to hear that? Would you be able to see it?
Yes. Yes. Because I wanted someone to point it out. But at the same time, because these titles that I had acquired, I mean, think about it. I came from a situation where I dropped out of school in the 8th grade, never went to high school, you know, got my GED in prison. Went to college while I was in prison, you know, and here I was getting a master's degree and I'm working on a doctorate, and people put me in the spotlight. So the last thing that I ever wanted to do was be exposed, so I hid a lot of it. I hid a lot of it, and it started to manifest itself in ways that were self-destructive. But at the same time, I was hoping for someone to pull me to the side and say, Richard, I see your pain. I see that even though you're smiling publicly, you're hurting behind closed doors. I see that. And yes, I would have been receptive, and that's actually something that, you know, I strive to do with the staff that I work with. Because I know that the people who are the most effective in doing this work are people who share some of the narrative of abuse, of oppression. But at the same time, because of my personal experience, I know that I need to sometimes pull them to the side and say, hey, what's going on with you? How's your healing process? What are you doing to take care of yourself? And it's at those moments that I really feel empowered, because it's mindful, it's reminding me of what I need to continuously engage in, and also utilizing that experience to help someone.
We got a question over here that I interrupted.
So, coming from a background of trauma and anger and self-destructive and everything, right, from very young, recognizing that coming back up, how do you work through that? How have you moved forward? Like, what, obviously, again, working through it is the process, but if you had to sum it up.
I don't hide it.
Right? You acknowledge it.
I acknowledge it.
And
I talk
channel
it. Yeah. I mean, I had already prepared, like, some really grand theoretical talk for tonight based on my doctoral research, But something's got to be to just come in and share my heart with everyone. Because I think that's the only way.
Right.
And it doesn't.
It's part of you.
Absolutely.
It has made you who you are, for better or worse, but you focus on the better.
Right.
And channel that.
Absolutely.
Okay. One more question.
This program sounds great. I love being part of it. You said with all these titles, that's what kept you from, I guess, revealing your true self. But did you find that your work was more powerful, more credible once you realized that you had the dream that you wanted to see in the world?
I didn't know.
Did your actions, did your words become more credible, more powerful when you realized that you had to be the change that you wanted to see?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, the irony about that is I was never really secretive about my past. Like, I talked about prison, I talked about abuse, but I never talked about what I was really feeling as a result of it. You know, I never talked about the harm that it really did and being so consumed with doing the work, which was really helpful for other people because they just needed to hear that they weren't the only ones going through whatever it was that they were going through. That they knew someone who looked like me, who presented like me, who had a particular title, who also knew what it was like to have a parent who struggled with crack addiction. That was helpful for them, but I really never talked about how it felt. I kept that part hidden. But
thank you.
Have you retained your family?
We have a working relationship, and I'm definitely in the life of my children. And working on maintaining a really healthy relationship with my ex-wife.
One last question in the back.
Yeah. So since you're working with the kids, I see that here a lot of kids, especially in the African American community, they grow without their father or the leading male figure. And as children, they learn a lot, they have a lot of emotions, and I think this anger inside themselves grows when they are small itself. Do you, when you work with your kids, do you address them? Do they open up to you, tell their anger that they don't have a father figure, they don't have a male figure? Do you try to address their anger at them at the small age itself so they don't keep growing with that?
Yeah, definitely. I acknowledge it. That's what it's also kind of normal. Because there's a reason for you being, you know, angry. And you know, the sad part about it is that, especially when it's stuff that takes place within the home, oftentimes we don't disclose that. So I'll talk to a young person, or even talk to an adult, and they say, my life growing up was great. And then gradually as the conversation progresses, you hear, my dad got locked up. Things changed.
Yep.
Or you say, when my mother started messing with crack, you know, that's when we had to start living with my grandmother. And so, you know, there's this fear of disclosing those personal issues and like putting on this front that takes place even early on. So I acknowledge all that and say that, hey, there's a reason for your anger, and there's also an opportunity for you to display this anger or use this anger in a constructive way that can not only benefit you, but benefit other people in the broader community. Thank you.
More conversation.